Greetings and welcome to virtual practical on performance analysis of cooling towers. There are two parts of this experiment. So today we will discuss the part one. This is a part of our term work of subject HVAC and R, lecture one. This particular video, we will discuss the theory on performance analysis of counterflow cooling tower and the experimentation on performance of experiment. In this, we will mainly discuss what are the objectives of this experiment, then how to take the observations in virtual practical, then how to generate the result tables, how to perform the calculations and the conclusions. Cooling tower is a type of heat exchanger, especially in direct contact cooling tower. The air and water comes in direct contact with each other. And during this contact, the air takes away the heat of water. At the same time, some water also evaporates along with the air. Now, if we consider a particular water droplet, so this is a water droplet of the temperature TS. So TS is the water temperature, so we can call it a saturation temperature. So surrounding of this water droplet, a film is generated, that is air film is generated, and surrounding is the atmospheric air. So this is actually a forced air. Fg is the heat transfer coefficient of the air. H is the enthalpy of unsaturated air, because this air is unsaturated. Hs is the enthalpy of saturated air, means when the air reaches to that particular temperature, and when the air gets saturated, its corresponding temperature. So that Hs we generally obtain with the help of the water temperature at that particular instant. Then there is heat as well as mass transfer is taking place from the water droplet. Obviously, in the cooling tower, water temperature is higher than the air temperature. So Ts is greater than T. T is the atmospheric air temperature. And Ts, that is also equal to Tw, that is water temperature. Now in this case, there is a heat as well as mass transfer is taking place. So the total heat transfer from the water bubble or the water droplet, it is the summation of sensible heat plus latent heat. Sensible heat is obtained by using convection relation, that is Ha delta T. So Fg is the heat transfer coefficient of unsaturated air, and the delta T, that is the temperature difference between the surface temperature of water droplet and the ambient temperature, that is surrounding air temperature T. And dA is the surface area of this water droplet. So this way we can calculate the sensible heat. So the heat is transferred from water droplet to air due to convection. Secondly, the latent heat is also transferred because air takes away some water vapor. So that latent heat is calculated by the enthalpy of evaporation, HFG, into mass flow rate of water vapor. So dot indicates the rate quantity. So everywhere there is a rate quantity. Now, the rate at which water evaporates, that is again calculated by using mass diffusion equation. So like sensible heat transfer, the mass evaporated, that is given by the formula Kw into Ws minus W. So this is a driving force for generating the mass flow rate of vapor. So Ws minus W, that is specific humidity. Ws is the specific humidity corresponding to saturated air, and W is the specific humidity corresponding to saturated air. And dA is the area, where Kw is the mass transfer coefficient. So this is mass transfer coefficient. So the putting this value in this equation, we get dQ L dot. So putting both dQs and dQ L dot, we get the equation of total heat transfer. So which is given by the sensible heat transfer plus latent heat transfer. Now here, where the mass transfer coefficient is also given by the expression. So that is Fg upon Cp, that is Cp is specific heat of air, and Fg is the heat transfer coefficient that we already discussed. So instead of Kw, that Kw is replaced by Fg by Cp. Now rearranging the term and taking Fg by Cp common, so we can have Cps into Ts plus HFgWs minus Cpt plus HFgW into Da. So this bracket quantity is called as a enthalpy value. So as per the definition of humid specific enthalpy, so this is enthalpy of saturated air, and this term is the enthalpy of unsaturated air. So we are putting these values. So instead of this bracket term, we can put HS, and for this bracket term, we can put H. So Fg by Cp in bracket HS minus H, that is dA. So this is dQT. Again, by putting the value of, instead of Fg by Cp, we can put Kw. And the dA is the differential area of this water droplet. So instead of that, we can put area into dV. So where A is the interfacial contact area of the surface of water droplet per unit volume of the equipment. So here the equipment, here the per unit volume of the droplet. So this is Kw. So the total rate of heat transfer can be given in terms of the mass transfer coefficient into interfacial contact area. This is also called as a weighted area per unit volume to dV. Enthalpy difference, that is HS minus H. Then in order to calculate the performance coefficient, especially our demand value, if we take the heat balance at of one particular section of the cooling tower, so there are three terms associated with the total heat transfer. So the total heat transfer is given by the heat removed from water at one particular section where the temperature difference is delta Tw. As the heat is removed, the minus sign is associated with this term. That is also equal to the heat is heat absorbed by air. So that is m dot A into dH. So that is heat absorbed by air. So dH is the enthalpy difference of unsaturated air. Dot A is the mass flow rate of air, and that is equal to the total heat transfer in terms of the mass transfer coefficient. So mass transfer coefficient into differential area into HS. Now if we equate first term and third term and the rearranging the term, so we get this expression. So by integrating, we get Cw delta Tw divided by HS minus H. So this is obviously a capital Tw, temperature difference. That is equal to Kw Av by m dot W. So these are the operating parameters. And for a particular section, these parameters are constants. So Kw mass transfer coefficient. Contact area is also a per unit volume of the equipment and m dot W. If we equate first and second term, then we can have this expression. So this is also related with the minus m dot W by m dot A. Now integration of equation 2 cannot be obtained directly because there are two variables. So for the purpose, the cooling tower is subdivided into n sections, and the integration is replaced by a summation of values prevailing in each section. Thus, Kwav by m dot W, that is equal to Cw, and instead of integration, so it is replaced by a summation from I is equal to 1 to I is equal to n sections. So the number of sections, if we increase, the accuracy of this particular coefficient increases. So that is delta Tw of I section HS minus H. So for every section, these parameters are measured. So where Kwav by m dot W, is known as performance coefficient of cooling tower. So this is actually a demand value of performance coefficient, because these values are obtained based on inlet conditions, and by dividing the entire cooling tower into n number of sections, and the intermediate temperatures we have divided equally. That's why it is a demand value. The performance coefficient can be obtained in actual practice, because if the summation is done by actual measurement in an experiment at each section, so at each section, if the delta T or the water temperature, air temperature, and enthalpies are calculated, then the actual value of performance coefficient is obtained. but it is found that the entering WBT of air and inlet water temperature do not affect the coefficient, because even once these conditions are fixed, then it doesn't affect on the coefficient. That is in case of demand value generally. But however, in practice, the values, if we change the value of mass flow rate, then the coefficient may vary. So the values of m dot w and m dot a do influence the water cooling and hence affect the coefficient. So in the demand value, it doesn't affect, but in actual practice, if we change the mass flow rate of water, that accordingly the cooling or delta T varies. So the variation of the coefficient of cooling tower as a function of m dot w by m dot a can be expressed, because this coefficient, which is obtained by actual measurements, can be a function of mass flow rate, mass ratio, that is mass flow rate of water and mass flow rate of air. So x and y are the coefficient, these are the constants. So if we rearrange the term, this particular equation takes the form of equation of line. This is y is equal to mx plus c. So this is the equation of line. So obviously, if we plot the line by taking this term on y-axis and this term on x-axis, we get a straight line. Then by actual plotting the curve, by taking the experimental value of Kw, performance coefficient, and the various values of m dot w by m dot a, we get a line, and from regression we can obtain this constant experimentally. So obviously this is a experimental value for variation of mass flow rates. So this particular expression can be used to obtain the experimental value of performance coefficient. So as far as the variation of experimental value and demand values is concerned, so first of all, the demand value, if you consider as the mass flow rate increases, the demand value of performance coefficient also increases. In this case, we have taken the performance coefficient on y-axis and the mass ratio on x-axis. So as the mass ratio increases, the requirement of cooling also increases. So performance coefficient is proportional to the cooling capacity. So as the more requirement is there, we need to increase the volume. We need to increase the contact area. So obviously we need the demand value increases as the mass flow rate increases. But for a particular cooling tower, if you see, as the mass flow rate increases, the performance coefficient decreases linearly, because it takes a form of equation of line. So it is a straight line. So this is a balance point, we can say the operation point. So if you operate the cooling tower at this particular point, that indicates your demand value is equal to the experimental value or available value, we can say. So the cooling tower performs, or it provides the cooling effect which is required. For example, if we require 5 degrees Celsius drop in temperature of cooling water, then at point C definitely we'll get that particular temperature drop. But if the mass flow rate is less than the mass flow rate at point number C, means if your point falls in this particular area, then what will happen? The demand value is less than the available value. So there is a possibility of overcooling. Means if we are expecting 5 degrees Celsius drop, we'll get more than 5 degrees Celsius drop. So the overcooling takes place, which is not harmful in most of the cases. But if the mass flow rate is greater than the mass flow rate at point number C, and then in this case, this is the experimental value. So the for a particular mass flow rate mass ratio, the experimental value is less than the demand value. So for example, at one, the experimental value is around 0.75, but the demand it is expecting that is around 1.25 like that. So in this case, your cooling tower provides less cooling as compared to the expected. So if you expect 5 degrees Celsius, in that case, the cooling tower gives less than 5 degrees Celsius. So this is that's why this performance coefficient is a measuring parameter of cooling tower. So it is desirable to have a higher performance parameters, actual available parameter than the demand value. So actually this curve is obtained by using this expression for different values of inlet conditions. And this particular curve is obtained by using the correlation, which is obtained experimentally. So this relation gives you available value, and this particular relation gives you demand value. So in our experiment, we have to determine these two values. Now we'll see the objectives of this experiment. As we have discussed earlier, we have to determine the performance coefficient in an induced draft counter current cooling tower for a given mass flow rate ratio. First, we have to calculate the required value, that is a demand value. And secondly, we have to obtain the available value, that is the experimental value. The third objective, we have to determine the interfacial contact area of the surface of water droplet per unit volume of the equipment. So that is a small a we have to determine. And in that case, if the heat transfer coefficient of the air is given, if it is known to us, that is around 100 watt per meter square Kelvin. So obviously, the heat transfer coefficient is higher in this case. Normally for still air, it is generally vary from 5 to 25 watt per meter square Kelvin. But as this is a forced air, because induced draft fan is used, so air is moving at comparatively higher velocity. So that's why as if the velocity increases, heat transfer coefficient increases. So heat transfer coefficient is higher. Cp, that is Cp of air, we can assume. And finally, we have to determine the power efficiency. So these are the objectives of the experiment. Now we have to perform this experiment virtually. Now in order to perform this experiment, this is a virtual setup of the cooling tower. This is induced draft cooling tower because the fan is fitted here. We can see the motor and the blades are here. So induced draft cooling tower. So the air is taken from the sideways. So two ways the air enters into the cooling tower. The water enters into the cooling tower, that is from the condenser, most of the cases. And through this common header, it is sprayed over this fill material, and the air and water comes in contact with each other. Their flow arrangement is counter flow basically. The air takes away heat as well as some water gets evaporated as well. And then the water gets cooled and the cold water is again sent to the condenser. Now the measurements required for calculating the performance coefficients are this is mass flow rate of water is required, so m dot w. So most of the cases with the help of rotameter or venturimeter we can measure this value, that is 12.62 kg per second. Then mass flow rate of air, So this we can measure by measuring the velocity at the top with the help of anemometer, and by measuring the cross-sectional area. So area into velocity gives you mass flow rate, and multiply by density gives you the area into velocity gives you volume flow rate, and multiply by density gives us mass flow rate. Then the temperature of air is given. So our inlet conditions we can measure, both DBT and WBT. So in the sample reading, we consider the DBT is 43.1 degrees Celsius, and WBT on the other side we take, because even if you write here also it is okay. So WBT we can measure with the help of psychrometer, which is 27 degrees Celsius. Water inlet temperature is 36.3 degrees Celsius, which is comparatively a warm water. And after cooling, the exit temperature of water, there is a drop of almost 5 degrees Celsius, 4 degrees Celsius, that is 32.1 degrees Celsius. So these are the operating parameters. So the geometric parameters are also required for this in order to calculate the volume. This is width of cooling tower, that is 2.616 meter we have considered. This is length of the cooling tower, 3.9624 meter. And the height of the cooling tower, that is 4.435 meter. So these parameters required for calculating the performance coefficient. This is observation table. We can write all these parameters here. Then in order to perform the results or result table, this is a schematic of cooling tower. So the cold water is sent to the condenser where it absorbs heat, and the warm water is again sprayed into the cooling tower. So in between there is a fill material. Now, in order to calculate the demand value, we first divide the entire cross-section or entire flow passage of the cooling tower into six sections. So for the convenience, as shown in figure. So this is section 1, section 2, section 3, section 4, section 5, and section 6. So 0 to 6. The temperature, entering temperature, we have considered as 36.3 degrees Celsius. And the exit temperature is also given, 32.1 degrees Celsius. So the water temperature drop for each section is calculated. So the total drop divided by 6, we get the drop in each section. So the section 1, so for each section, it is calculated around 0.7 degrees Celsius in this case. So the temperature drop is 0.7. So the temperature is reduced by 0.7 when it moves from 6 to 5. So like that, continuously there is a temperature drop, and at the outlet the temperature is around 32.1 degrees Celsius. So this is temperature drop of water. This we can consider. Now the air enters from the bottom, as we have seen in previous diagram. So the DBT of air is 43.3 degrees Celsius and WBT is 27 degrees Celsius. The air enters from the bottom. Then air gains the heat, and that reflects in the enthalpy of the air. So the total enthalpy drop we can calculate. So for each section, so for if we consider a particular section, so for particular section, if we take up heat balance, so MCP delta TW, that is the heat removed from the water, that is equal to MA into delta H. So this small delta H is the enthalpy drop, enthalpy increase, enthalpy of air increase in one particular section. So that comes around 3.108. So this is a rise of enthalpy in one particular section. Because while taking this heat balance, you have to take delta TW as 0.7. So 0.7 is the temperature drop at one particular section. CPW is constant, M dot W is same, and M dot A is same. So MCP delta T of water, that is equal to M dot A into delta H. So this is heat balance. We can calculate delta TH value. Now, in order to calculate the inlet enthalpy value, so we use psychrometry chart because the inlet condition is given. So we can locate this point on psychrometry chart. So 43 degrees Celsius and 27 degrees Celsius WBT. So corresponding to this point, we can extract the value of enthalpy. So enthalpy is 84.753. And in order to calculate the enthalpy at next section, we have to add the value of 3.10. So similarly, we can add the values of 3.108 in each values. That is, we add here 3.10, we get this value. Then by adding 3.108, we get this value and so on. So H values we get. Now, in order to calculate HS value, so first of all, we'll assume this TW value is STS because the air, when it's saturated, its temperature is equal to the temperature of water. So the saturated air value we can consider as TS, which is equal to the water temperature. So obviously, the corresponding to 84, the temperature is 32 degrees Celsius. So reverse order we can write, that is 32 to 36 degrees Celsius. This is temperature. And we have to get this value of HS. Again, this HS value we get from psychrometry chart corresponding to saturation curve. So all these points we can locate saturation. So 32 degrees Celsius till it intersects saturation curve. So from this point, we can extract the value of enthalpy. So at this particular point, the enthalpy value is 104.385. So similarly, we can get the values of enthalpy corresponding to other temperatures, that is 32.8, 33.9. So this way we get the values of HS. So these values we have to obtain because in order to calculate the demand value. So in this particular case, we have only considered the inlet conditions. So that is, in these are based on the inlet condition of air, and this is based on the inlet water temperature. And remaining values we have obtained with equal difference. So we have divided the section, entire flow section, into six number of sections. And each section there is a equal drop in temperature as well as equal rise in enthalpies and corresponding HS values. Then 1 upon HS minus H, this value we can calculate. So for section 1, the value is average of these two. For section 2, the value is average of these two. This is for section 3, this is for section 4, this is for section 5, and this is for section 6. So at each section we get this value. And now, as per the definition of performance coefficient of demand value, it is given by this expression. So delta TW in our case is fixed, it is 0.7, and 1 upon HS minus H for each section we have considered. So there are six values of 1 upon HS minus H, and delta TW and CW we can take common. So by putting all these values, we get the value of performance coefficient. This is a required value. The available value is calculated by using this correlation. So this correlation may vary from cooling tower to cooling tower. So we consider this KW value because as per the size, this value, this correlation is given in the book. So we take as it is. But in actual practice, this correlation is obtained at the time of testing of the cooling tower after manufacturing. So from this, we get the available value. This is experimental value and this is a demand value. Now you can see the experimental value is less than the demand value. Means your cooling tower is not performing at the expected capacity. Obviously, you need to improve that capacity. Now, in order to improve the capacity, first of all, this is required. So we can increase the number of field materials so that the available cooling value may increase. So this way we can improve. So by improving the contact area. So in order to calculate interfacial area, so that the interfacial area of weighted area of the tower per unit volume, so that is small a. So this value known to us. So from that, the volume of the cooling tower we have already measured, so that we can take m dot. It is m dot w actually. So m dot w is the mass flow rate of water, and in order to calculate kw, the heat transfer coefficient and specific heat is also given. So kw we can calculate by using heat transfer coefficient and specific heat. So putting these values, we can obtain the value of interfacial weighted area. This is interfacial contact area per unit volume of the equipment. So this unit is meter square per meter cube. So this value comes around 5.14. Then the cooling tower efficiency can be obtained by using the formula of efficiency, that is actual temperature drop upon maximum possible temperature drop. Actual temperature drop of water is inlet temperature minus outlet temperature, which is already we have measured. And the maximum possible temperature drop is the inlet temperature minus WBT of entering air, which is in this case, it is 27 degrees Celsius. So by putting all this value, we can calculate the tower efficiency. So tower efficiency is around 0.4516. So finally, the result table, the performance coefficient of required value is 1.02. Performance coefficient of available value is less, 0.76. So we can write the conclusion as the available coefficient is less than the required value. The cooling capacity of the tower is less than the expected. Then the value of interfacial weighted area of the tower per unit volume, that comes around, in this case, is 5.14. So these are the simulated values, because we will provide one simulator. So from that, if you put all the input conditions, the simulator will calculate all these values. So all these calculations you have to perform, and you have to manually obtain these values, and you have to write here. And finally, you have to write the conclusion as well. The value of calculated are values calculated are approximately same as the simulated values. So with the help of simulators, so simulator is especially used to validate your results. So in your case, you have to perform these calculations manually, and you have to validate your results with the help of simulator results. So at the end of this particular session, you will be able to explain the analysis of heat and mass transfer through cooling tower. So how to calculate the different heat quantities in the cooling tower, and how to develop the various expressions of the cooling tower. So there are three expressions associated with the cooling tower. That is heat removed from water, which is equal to the heat absorbed by air, which is also equal to the real equation, which is in terms of interfacial contact area, volume of the cooling tower, and the mass transfer coefficient, the enthalpy difference. Secondly, you will be able to determine performance coefficient of cooling tower by performing actual calculations using psychrometry chart. Also, in actual case, whenever you come across the cooling tower, you will be able to perform experiment on cooling tower as well. So what kind of measurements required, you will come to know after this video. It is expected. Then calculate the performance parameters of cooling tower, different performance parameters like demand value of performance coefficient, then available value of performance coefficient, then power efficiencies and interfacial contact area. Also, that is mass transfer coefficient can also be calculated. So with this, we have completed the part one. In part two, I will mainly explain how to extract the reading from the one interactive video, how to download the simulator, and how to write the experiment. So that we will discuss in the next part. Thank you very much.